Yeah, Chicago needs that. That's
I
what I'm
mean,
saying. Yeah, I love that slow motion section. You could still read like the letters and numbers on the track and shit.
yeah. I mean, with the iPhone catches about 60 frames a second or so. So each one of those frames was 1/60th of a second. It was quite badass.
Yeah, so like I took that and just, that section I just put it into extreme slow motion and you could just see like all the really good clear detail that you couldn't see at the regular speed.
Another way in which technology makes our lives better. I have a slow motion camera on my phone that just is in my pocket and also makes phone calls.
Yeah, and I mean, the only thing preventing that sort of technology from going up in more cities again, it is just too many people trying to cling on to obsolete industry and not allowing for expansion. They've also got, they've had the technology for a while for maglev trains that could go like, Mach 4 that, you could work in San Francisco and, take your lunch break in Chicago, like insane. And I actually heard something about somewhere in Japan they started building a prototype finally and are wanting to test that technology. I mean, I'm sure it probably just goes in a big circle or something. It's not like a full deployment, it's just a prototype. But basically the reason that maglev can go so fast is because it's actually hovering in the middle of a tube, just via electromagnetism, so there's really no friction.
Right. Yeah,
So
Elon Musk is actually proposing something very similar, except it uses vacuum instead of magnets. It levitates off the track with magnets, but it actually uses vacuum to suck it from one place to another. It's an interesting concept. We'll see where it goes. I think the guy is more concerned right now with colonizing Mars, so he's got slightly dry.
yeah, so I mean, well, he may or may not realize that he's never gonna colonize anything off of this planet until this planet does some major shifts with its paradigms about a lot of things because there's too much politics, bureaucracy, money issues, etc. That would prevent him from doing it. So like even if he had all the right technology on the drawing board and it was totally possible to do, all the bureaucracy and all the other issues are just going to shut him down in 2 seconds. It's just going to be like, nope, sorry, can't.
Yep, and then when humanity is ready, they'll go do it. I mean, we've had technology for a long time, and really we just need consciousness to expand to a point where we're actually willing to use it.
I mean, when you got too many paradigms in the way, something that in a more benevolent society and more efficient society would cost, $1 million to manufacture, then costs like 100 trillion just because bureaucracy and stupidity and everything else. And, on that sort of a scale, you cannot fund any sort of Mars colonization because it would take more money than Earth actually has. So it's just like you're not going to do it.
Yeah, a bit of a hard limit there.
Yeah, totally. Where's Katerina?
Right here.
She's right over there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's listening, but not necessarily contributing. But here, let me put the spotlight on her. There she is.
So what else do you want to say about all this stuff and your thoughts on this year and
Came up on my news feed. It says, "Be thankful for every heartbreak, for they were planned. They come into your life to reveal another layer of yourself to you, and then leave. Their purpose is to shake you up, tear apart your ego a little bit, show you your obstacles and addictions, break your heart open so new light can get in, make you so desperate and out of control that you have to transform your life, and you do." Paradigm shifting.
Interesting.
It was kind of relevant for me.
everybody totally fears heartbreak, fears betrayal. As a matter of fact,
heartbreak. I'm not talking
the other day.
Relationship though, heartbreak.
I know.
Anytime.
I know. Anything. I understand. I know. I was just going to say that the other day, Kristen brought up something that Gangaji had said in a video that I'm paraphrasing, but. You know, we tend to try to run from and avoid heartbreak, you know, so much that our hearts just get broken by default of trying to run away from it, that we...
Yeah, you told me that.
We're doing the opposite of what we're intending. Instead of avoiding heartbreak, we're setting ourselves up for it in the act of trying to avoid it. Instead of looking at the idea of heartbreak as, you know, just another learning lesson. If we just saw it as just another learning lesson, it wouldn't happen nearly as often. But if we're viewing it as the enemy, then it's a problem. Just like what Gangaji said, suffering is created from. Suffering is the always trying to run from pain and run towards pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas both are going to happen, that's inevitable. And if you embrace both instead of running towards one and away from the other, then there wouldn't be all the suffering. Because the suffering is always in the running. Having that terrifying monster always, you know, feeling like it's always chasing you. And at the same time, running towards pleasure so much, feeling as if no matter what you do, it's not good enough. Oh, it's not obtainable because I'm so busy running away from this monster over here that no matter how much I run towards pleasure, no matter how much I run towards what I want, I just can't. It's just not obtainable. Because the only place we could do anything is in the now. And if we're 50% focused in the past and 50% focused in the future, regret of the past, worrying about the future, then what are we doing in the now? Nothing. Mm-hmm. Suffering.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I totally see that.
Anything else you want to add on these points?
No, that was my contribution.
Other than seeing me this summer, what are you looking forward to with 2017?
I just think this year, I'm looking forward to more connection with people. Like I'm having people reach out to me like already, just in this really unity consciousness kind of way. Like I had someone reach out to me tonight, like in all seriousness, asking me if I've ever thought about Jehovah's Witnesses. And like, but like she made really good points about consciousness and like, you know, for her, like she's been reading the Bible and stuff and she's also a person who's been like in this new awareness, new consciousness kind of movement of, you know, I don't really like calling it new age, but like, you know, new paradigm thought, you know, so expanding the mind and thinking for oneself. And she also is like me in the sense that she's been revisiting the Bible and really learning from it and really gaining knowledge and understanding from it when previously her mind was closed to it and mm-hmm. was not interested in learning from it, the book, because she just wrote it all off as nonsense and then just would seek spiritual teaching from every other place except the Bible, you know, thinking she was being all unity consciousness and love and light, you know, not like embracing of everything while still having this blind spot, you know, and that was me too.
Even General Patton won a lot of his battles through biblical influence. He would look to the Bible for inspiration and form workable battle strategies. Not that I'm advocating war, but just saying it happened.
Yeah, well, I get it. Like I am also applying biblical knowledge in my life and seeing the effects it's having. Like on me personally, like honestly, if you want to talk about sovereignty, look to Jesus. Jesus teaches sovereignty in ways that New Agers could not even understand.
Like, yeah, totally.
Like could not even understand. And it's just like this level of personal power, like it's all of it, like the biblical knowledge is influencing me as well. And really empowering me in these new ways to really speak my truth more and to not be afraid and to really not be afraid and to really just trust that I'm okay and that nothing, no, like if God is for us, who can be against us kind of stuff, you know, it's really emboldening me. And I feel like that is what I'm most looking forward to in 2017 is just being able to have more of these open-hearted conversations with people, to be able to really relate and be human with each other rather than having all of the fucking masks on and all the pretenses and all of the whatever uppity bullshit that happens as a result of all of these ego paradigms that have been in the way. Like, I'm so enjoying how much more soulful connection I can have with people these days. It's so enjoyable and refreshing.
Yeah, totally. And 2017, it's just like, this is just perfect year with perfect timing. Like, you know, PSEC just joined CCN.
Yeah, that'll be really fun.
Yeah, Tuesday, January 10th, 4 p.m. Central, 10 p.m. GMT, you know, ccn.media. People will be able to check that out. And I've already got a PSEC episode explaining what's all up with that, so I'm not going to go into that here. If anybody wants to know that's watching this now, they can go watch the other one. But I just thought that, you know, the timing was really cool that it's happening for 2017, and it really is all about that integration and expansion sort of thing, and a willingness for, you know, for people to really put things together and to learn and to grow and to expand and all of that, and instead of, you know, the whole dickwag. It's like, you know, first in the beginning there was, you know, one plus decades ago, there was, you know, the so-called fringe nuts, truthers, this and that. They were the extreme minority. They started real small. They grew to a certain point of awareness, but they still have, you know, the dickwag ego thing going on. But they still triumphed a lot over the older mainstream paradigm that was previous. And now it looks like, you know, there's another group of people that isn't, that it's not about an idea of, oh, we need a movement, or we need this group or that protocol or this new strategy or whatever, but it's more like a growing awareness in people about exactly all the things, you know, we've already discussed on this hangout, and who are really just as sick of all the left-right paradigm dickwagging, just as sick of that as the truth movement has ever been sick of, you know, the mainstream bullshit. And it's like the truth movement was like the first step, like, you know, like birth to, you know, 1.5 or something. And now we're at the stage of like getting rid of the diapers and putting on the big boy pants and, you know, and moving into that. And then soon humanity will hit puberty, so to speak, and et cetera, et cetera. You know, I mean, it just kind of looks like it's just this unfolding.
Mm-hmm.
That it's just going into stages of unfolding, and people like you and me and, you know, Melanie Vermeer and Richard and et cetera, are just, you know, a part of this, you know, this next experience that people are having, where we're looking around and going, all right, well, you know, the truth movement did so much and all that, but it's time to be more about truth. It's time to be more than just, oh, here's this data, believe what I say, don't believe what they say, to move mm-hmm. beyond that and really take personal responsibility in who we are as a person and how we act and how we treat each other, and really making some decisions of how we want to live life instead of just how we want to discuss life. You know, topics are all well and wonderful, but how are we living our lives?
Totally. Yeah, it's so much more about the practical application, and I'm happy about that, because, you know, you and I have had a lot of practice at practical application, and so I feel like you and I have been preparing for this, and, you know, it's perfect that we're, like, now on CCN and stuff, because
I feel like our wealth, our treasure trove of experience will now really equip us well to be able to speak about this from an intelligible place.
Yeah, I think it's just going to be a really great a great catalyst, and not the only one. I mean, you know, you got Max Egan out there doing his thing, and he's been speaking on these ideas, well before now. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, though they like a lot of stuff of what he says, they just look at him kind of weird. They can't get their minds fully around this whole, like, wait a minute, we don't have to dickwag with each other, you know, kind of concept. And a lot of them just haven't been able to process that part of what Max is saying.
Right.
And now I think we're starting to move into a time where more people are going to be able to process that part of it and just be like, oh yeah, that does make more sense. If we actually walk our talk instead of just talking our talk, and our motivations are being the best person we could be instead of shoving our view down everyone's throats, then that will get us going more to where we're wanting to go instead of remaining stuck in the same ruts. Because the truth movement's looking around like, okay, we've been doing all this truth telling, but there hasn't been as much active change or practical application as we would like. And they look at it and go, oh, well, is humanity lost? Is humanity hopeless? We've talked and talked and talked and talked, and not much has gotten done. It's like, well, yeah, if everybody's just talking and no one's willing to do, then what the fuck do you expect? Start doing.
Doing like how?
Doing and being the change instead of just talking about, oh, Federal Reserve Bank and Illuminati and fractional reserve banking and Ponzi schemes and corruption here and pedophilia there. It's like, it's all well and good and fine to, you know, get all this information out and make people aware. That's all well and great. But like, what are people actually doing and being in their own lives to actually create positive change? You know, are they being the type of person that they want? No, they're angrily arguing with people and arguing with their fellow truthers and, you know, it's saying nasty things like, you know, one person is hooked on one piece of information as one piece of the puzzle. Somebody else gets another piece, but instead of them realizing they each have a piece of the puzzle, each of them think they have the whole picture. So then they start calling each other government shills and deceptions and psyops and, oh, this person's bad and that person's trying to deceive you. And so instead of working together, you know, they do it exactly what... Like, you know, they talk about how the elites use divide and conquer strategy. It's like, well, duh, it's still working on you fucking people. You know, you think you're awake, but you're not. You're aware, but, you know, you're not really awake because you don't have any freaking compassion and you're still falling for the same old games. Mm-hmm. Because if you have compassion, you're not going to fall for the same old games. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people are waking up into that. Just like similarly, that one person that you just mentioned woke up, you know, out of the idea that, oh, I guess all this lovey-lighty shit isn't all there is to it. And I mean, yeah, the lovey-lighty stuff has its merit and value and up to a point. It's correct up to a point, but there's more than that. Mm-hmm. And if you limit yourself to just that, you're going to be pretty useless because there's all this other data and all this other means of applying yourself that, you know, that you're rejecting. And right. So the same thing with the truth movement. They're so caught in their little bubbles and so intolerant of anybody else's point of view that they all end up fighting each other, and that's what the psychopaths want us to do anyway. So whether you're talking, and you know, and I mean, even within subsections of the lovey-lighty community, it's the same thing. All these different people in narcissistic bubbles fighting with each other. Like, look at what happened, you know, between Teal Swan and Jordan LaButthurt. And Jordan was like, oh, Teal is a MK Ultra government agent, blah, blah. It's like, really, dude? Really? Like, that is all love and light? That is fucking spiritual? Fucking lashing out at your peers and saying that they work for the government? Whatever, dude.
Yeah, that's a tough thing.
He put all this energy into this big dick wag with Teal. And he was ignoring the shit out of us because we were making too many good points. that would be PSEC 2015 information is just information. Or maybe that was 2014. Pretty sure it was 2015 though. But anyway, yeah, that was that one. And it was totally hilarious. We were all just getting ignored out of existence because we were making good points on there. And Jordan was just, you know, just in this whole dickwag thing. And, you know, he just, and he, Jordan's married to, or married or boyfriend or whatever the hell he is, the significant other of Leah Tarunen. And I think he's more than just a little bit of a control freak and a narcissist, because he's up there saying, my way's the only way. Everybody else works for the government. And I'm just like, whatever. But a lot of people get like that in the spiritual movement. So, I mean, that's just an example. I'm not trying to single him out or anything, but that's just one of many jillion freaking examples out there. And, you know, all these different people in groups, they have the same objective, love and light, make the world better and positivity, but they focus more on fighting each other and being suspicious and worried and, oh, I have to protect myself against the dark entities. Ooh, protection, fear. And it's just like, if you're in that state of fear and in that narcissistic bubble, then what good are you going to be? Then you're just doing the opposite of what you're intending. So I think a lot of people are starting to realize, hey, if you remain stuck in a bubble, whether it's a new agey bubble or a truther bubble or pick your bubble, fundamentalist Christian bubble, fundamentalist Muslim bubble, fundamentalist anything bubble, whatever the fuck it is, that you're really, really limiting yourself and limiting your impact.
Yeah. And like, I think fundamentalist Christians get such a bad rap because, I mean, I know that there can be people who are technically a fundamentalist Christian who do not act in the typical stereotype of what we're deeming as fundamentalist Christian and hateful and vengeful and spiteful and mean and nasty. Like, you know, that's also a judgment. That's also a sweeping generalization of all people in a group. So it's like, you know, I think the more that all of us can start to pull back the definitions and the layers and the perceptions we have of all different types of people and stop judging everybody by their cover and to stop, like, really, you know, just broad brushing everybody, you know, people of all groups, like Muslims and terrorists and blah, blah, blah.
I think that fundamentalist extremists are the extreme minority of any group, but they have such big mouths and the silent majority don't stick up for themselves that people are just under the impression that this tiny little bitty micro group speaks for the larger whole when they don't. But unfortunately, the larger whole is letting them do it because they won't speak up and say, hey, that view doesn't represent us.
Exactly.
So, like, you know, I'll even tell Muslims, like, you know, don't be so surprised that a lot of non-Muslims hate you and are scared of you because you've got these radical idiots doing jihads and whatever and saying all this crazy shit. And where are you speaking up against it? Where is your voice? You're too locked into a state of fear and you don't want to speak up, but you're the majority. There's like, at most, probably like a million, and that's probably even too high of a figure, a million dangerous, crazy, wacko Muslims, and the rest of the Muslims, which are like almost a billion or whatever, those are just the ones that want to be left the hell alone and live in peace like everybody else. So if that 99.9% majority would just speak up and say, hey, see those crazies over there? They don't represent us. Then, you know, things would roll a bit differently. But if you don't stand up and be heard, don't stand up and cast your vote in that way and say, hey, this is my sovereignty. I stand in solidarity. If you don't do that, then the high school gossip factor kicks in and just everybody of different groups believes that because these minority of wackos are speaking up, but no one else is, that they represent the majority. And then you get stereotyped.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yep. So that's why I also do as much speaking up as I can for myself and just say, hey, you know, I might agree with something these different groups say and disagree with other aspects and whatever, but you know, I'm just me and nobody represents me but me, and I don't have wacko nutcases representing me. I speak for myself. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Yep, getting practiced at that myself.
Yep, we're learning. We're all learning. None of us have the stem perfect.
My battery is about to die.
I see that? The power of your hotness. The computer cannot handle it. Yeah. So you were talking.
Well, shouldn't the power of her hotness then actually be charging the battery?
You would think. I mean, if only I could figure out a way to harness Katerina's hotness, we could solve all world energy.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I'm working on it. I'm working on harnessing her hotness. I feel like
my hotness. Why am I hot?
Well, so that we could convert your hotness into electrical energy.
I'm just asking why you think I'm hot.
Because your butt is very lay down onable.
So he thinks I'm hot just because of my body, apparently.
Mm-hmm. Only because of your body, because I'm shallow.
Yeah, only because of my body. He's shallow.
This is why we've had a really fulfilling relationship for a long period of time, is because I'm actually shallow, but I've hidden it pretty well.
Yeah, he'd sell you as a piece of art, but that would be illegal.
Yeah, I mean, when she wants to gallery, like, clientele definitely approves.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
For the viewing audience, this is pure sarcasm, just in case anyone who is sarcasm illiterate might be watching.
Are you sarcastic about the people coming into the gallery?
No.
That wasn't sarcastic.
I was being sarcastic.
Well, I mean acting as if you're nothing more than a sex object. That's what he's being sarcastic about.
Oh yeah, exactly. Totally. We make jokes about this all the time. Right. We actually really love and respect each other.
Yeah, she's nothing more than a sex object, but only between the hours of like 10 p.m. and 4 a.m.
Yeah.
And sometimes in the afternoon. Sometimes like
afternoon
between 12
delight.
And 1. But other than that, she's like a totally respected member of the household.
So basically you're saying there are hours where you get to disrespect her.
With my consent.
There's no disrespect.
No disrespect happening.
No.
So Paul, is there anything else you want to add to anything that has been discussed so far? Any other thoughts you want to get in? I know there's something other than a thought you'd like to get into Katerina, but that's besides the point.
Into a mood where it's definitely does not benefit me to continue doing a PSEC episode.
Now we can finish the PSEC episode.
We totally can. Yeah.
We don't have to stiff Dave like that.
I feel like to conclude the point that you were talking about with regard to integration, I believe that people finding their voice, specifically people of various religious groups, I mean, like, I talk about my Christianity. I never talked about my Christianity before, but I share it on the internet now, because, like, if other people can say what they believe, why can't I say what I believe? And my voice gets to say that the Westboro Baptist folks who are out there saying God hates fags are a bunch of idiots who don't represent what Christ actually has to say.
Yeah.
And so if I'm silent, if I don't actually render an opinion on that, then you would be perfectly legitimate in assuming that I have the same exact viewpoint, but I don't. Mm-hmm. And so therefore it's important for me to talk about what my viewpoint is. Otherwise you, with your lack of telepathy skills, would not know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, I was, you know, brought up like, Lutheran Missouri Synod, Christian, but I don't really like the way they roll on things. I kind of consider myself more spiritual / Gnostic Christian, because Gnostic is, the root word is gnosis, which means knowledge through experience, and I really think that that more accurately represents what Jesus was about. Jesus wasn't all like, oh, blindly believe in me, and if you don't, fuck you, you're gonna burn. You know, he was really all about to applying love and applying appreciation and applying thankfulness and really being proactive in taking the concepts and being about the doing. Whereas he would always complain that, you know, the Pharisees do a lot of talky talk, but other than like shovel wealth into their pockets, what else do they do? Do they really do anything? No, they don't. They do a lot of talk, but they don't really walk the walk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's all about, like, you know, practical and applied, which is another, you know, the only way Katerina and I are integrating is that, yeah, what money, power, sex is going to be about. Money, power, sex is all about applied spirituality. That's the whole thing.
And I believe that the point of Jesus was not, oh, believe in him and he suffered for you so you don't have to. No, we live in a world of suffering. This is a world of suffering. That's not what Jesus did. What Jesus, I think the point he was making is that he came off of his cross of suffering, and so can we, that we can paradigmally resurrect into, you know, something better than we were, that the old mind prison entrapped person that we used to be can, instead of be perpetually suffering on our cross of misery, can die on that cross, and we can then be reborn, resurrected into that new state of being, that new state of awareness, that Christ consciousness, you know, whatever. And, you know, I don't think that it means, oh, well, you know, Jesus died for your sins, so let's not disappoint him, haha. You know, I don't believe that, oh, if I believe in the scapegoat, you know, social title called Christ, I could just, you know, I can do all this crazy shit and I'm saved, quote unquote, no matter what. But, you know, if I don't believe in the social title, then even if I was a totally good person, that this pissed off, supposedly unconditionally loving toddler God that is nothing but like Hitler on steroids is just going to toss me into a pit of fire if I, you know, so much as, you know, hold my dick the wrong way when I piss or whatever. And it's like, I don't believe in all that. And, you know, there's so many Christians that believe in that dysfunctional sort of God, you know, and they just don't really resonate with my view of God. And they're like worried that I might be going to hell or whatever. And it's just like, well, if you're right and I'm wrong, then so be it. But I just can't bring myself to believe that the universe is so poorly designed and that God is just this divine Nazi tormentor that is worse than an abusive parent. It's just going to be like, all right, I'm going to put all my kids down on earth and like not give them shit. And like, they got to like blindly poke around. And like, if they fall into any of the holes and traps because they can't see, then, oh, well, I'm just going to throw them in a pit of hell to burn for all eternity. No, I don't. I'm sorry. I don't believe in that kind of a God. And I think that shit is just us anthropomorphizing our human insecurities onto something we perceive as greater than us, so we create this big divine Nazi in order so that we can, you know, justify our own bullshit. We project that onto God, and that's just not the way God is, in my opinion. That's, I can't really, you know, see that as being real or plausible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and when it comes right down to it, I feel like you can either believe a God that you understand, or you can believe in an omnipotent God, but you can't believe in both. The God that is omnipotent is, by definition, beyond my understanding, and consequently, any ideas that I have about God are necessarily limited.
Yeah, so it basically boils down to, you know, you can either believe that you know, a being, or at the very least a consciousness or a force or an energy of some sort has created and or is a part of and or controls or defines or whatever a universe that is so well designed that level of perfect function is well beyond our current capability to understand. And therefore would not be subject to all of the various dysfunctions that we look around at ourselves and say, okay, we have that, so God must have that too. I think it's just the ultimate in psychological projection, and I think it's really stupid.
Yeah, be careful about making God in your own image.
Okay, the audio just went weird on me for a second. Was that your end or mine?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Oh, there we go. You're back.
I had just said, be careful about creating God in your own image. It's like the Bible talks about God creates man in God's image, and then man turns right around and creates God in man's image.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, looking at it objectively, like all these different sub-denominations of Christianity, and then you've got, you know, the Muslim religion and, you know, Buddhism and this, that, and whatever. It's like, you know, like look at all the top religions that have like the most followers, and then they have all these sub-denominations and whatever that also believe as differently as they believe, you know, the same thing. They believe different too. It's like out of all these tons of different choices, if you ask the question, which one is the ultimate absolute right one? It's like, you know, if you look at that logically, you can only come to the conclusion that they're all just as right as they are wrong, that they all have similarities and differences.
Possibly come to is that it's grace. It's that this benevolent thing that created us has in its own benevolent grace has already decided what the hell's going to happen, and it's going to be for our good. Because do you believe in a benevolent God, or you believe in a not so benevolent one? And since you don't have a choice in the matter, pick the nicer one.
People always ask, well, if God was so benevolent, why would bad things be allowed to happen? Well, that's an easy one. Free will. Without free will, then God would be the divine Nazi. He would be like, well, everything has to be this way and you don't get a choice. But we have free will. And so that is what allows for that, because our free will is not going to be interfered with. So if we choose to do something nasty, we have the free will to do that. That doesn't mean God is doing something nasty.
Well, it also doesn't mean that, it doesn't even mean that it's particularly nasty. It simply means that we perceive it that way. That we have made our own judgment call as to being like, this is thing. Murdering somebody is nasty. When in fact, murdering somebody may very well be the absolute best thing that could have possibly happened to them, and thus it was all foreordained a long time ago, before time itself, and is inherently good, though we perceive it as being bad or nasty.
Well, I also don't necessarily think that it was necessarily inherently good any more than it was inherently bad. Sometimes it's simply a matter of consequences for actions. You allow tyrants in control, you're going to get things like genocide and other stuff. Like, you touch fire, you get burned. It's not that the fire is punishing you for touching it. It's just a consequence for action. So if you don't want things like genocide, then don't let tyrants rule over you and stop giving tyrants power. So I don't think that lesson is good or bad. It's just like fire isn't good or bad. It's, you know, it's just fire burns. If you don't want to get burned, don't touch it. It's, you know.
Can you read something that just came up on my feed about, this is really cool. This is very interesting. Sure. It's called 11-22-33 Degrees of Kundalini Consciousness. It's a Gnostic Kundalini teaching.
Okay.
And it ties in, like, spirituality very well here. Kundalini is because of the energy that facilitates all spiritual development. The Kundalini is at the base of all existence. It is the raw foundational energy that the spiritual seeker wants to cultivate, develop, or awaken, depending on which tradition or term they use. The word Kundalini is most known from the Sanskrit language, yet it is even more ancient than that language. It has roots that go back to Atlantis and beyond.
Kundalini refers to a cosmic force, an energy unlike any energy that we know physically. Kundalini's not mere electricity or magnetism or heat, but it is the source of them all. Kundalini is a kind of force or energy that is pure, divine, raw potentiality that is then modified according to its condition. This is the key fact that is often missing in many texts or schools of Hinduism or Buddhism who discuss Kundalini. In the West, Kundalini is also a basic foundational aspect of religion, but it is more veiled. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, it is symbolized as the fire of the Holy Spirit, or the column of fire that led the Israelites in their great exodus. In reality, any spiritual practice that we perform, any kind, whether recitation of mantras, meditation, prayer, devotional singing, karma yoga, or selfless service, all of these spiritual practices, no matter what tradition it comes from, has its intention the awakening of this cosmic force within us. There is no exception to this. The very purpose of religion or yogis to awaken this energy inside of, or purpose of religion or yoga is to awaken this energy inside of the person. We seek to activate that force because that energy connects us to the divine. It produces in us what can be called enlightenment or liberation. However, do not confuse this with realization, which depends on cognizance, wisdom, and understanding. The energy of Kundalini is not active in people today. That is because the conditions that activate it have not been satisfied. Like any energy or force in nature, the energy of Kundalini, the Holy Spirit, functions according to the laws of nature. It functions according to cause and effect. Everything in nature, even God, respects the law of cause and effect. Karma, this law of action and consequence, modifies everything. Every manifested thing is subject to cause and effect. Kundalini is no exception. The arising of Kundalini works like any law in nature. When the causes are satisfied, the effects result. This is why, when we observe society and the world, we see the psychological and spiritual level of humanity where it is because of cause and effect. Humanity is where it is because of the causes that humanity has created. Our current situation, whether social, economic, or political, every aspect of our life is as it is because of our actions. There is no exception to that. There is nothing beyond being imposed upon us from outside. Everything we experience is the result of what we are inside. The same is true of the awakening of Kundalini. This cannot occur by the intervention of any outside force. There are groups that state that Kundalini is dangerous, that it can be awakened by accident. This is false. It is impossible. Why? Because Kundalini is the intelligence of God. God does not act by accident. Enlightenment or liberation does not come by accident. Enlightenment is a result of precise causes. To produce those causes requires great effort and a lot of knowledge. God, divinity, the divine mother, does not enlighten anyone randomly by accident or on a whim. Therefore, we can dispense with a huge expanse of books, theories, schools, and teachers who repeat all of this nonsense about Kundalini. What we should do is study the actual scriptures, the experiences of those who have truly worked with this energy and who have the corresponding sign, brilliant purity, wisdom, and radiant intelligence, and rely upon their guidance. We should set aside those people who are just trying to make money, gather followers, or become famous. When we examine the scriptures and the great teachers, both past and present, we discover that this force of Kundalini, the Holy Spirit, is extremely powerful, but also extremely demanding. It only enlightens those who deserve it. Those who deserve the presence of that force within enter into a very different experience of life. Someone who has this energy active within them does not see life the way a common person does. These are from the Gnostic teachings.
Yeah, totally. I think they're also kind of talking about what Einstein referred to as the ether and what modern science refers to as the zero-point field, like the source of all. Science is even starting to realize, kind of getting into the thought that instead of space being that which is between matter, as if space is just some empty nothing, and that, you know, you've got space and then matter in the space, but the space itself is nothing. They're starting to think that, you know, because they're seeing that the universe is an electric universe, and that physical reality is more holographic, that space is where matter is actually projected from, like, you know, the projector in the back of a movie theater projecting the experience to the screen, that space, that what we call space, is that which reality is projected from, and not just simply empty nothingness that exists between the something.
Mm-hmm.
So science is starting to look at it a little more in that direction. At least the aspects of science that are getting away from Newtonian absolutism and realize that things work electrically, not like billiard balls.
Mm-hmm.
So on that level, you realize that, excuse me, thoughts, emotions, beliefs, everything, it's all energy. It all interacts with everything else. There are configurations, and as I like to say, you know, reality is a cake, not a light switch. So the configuration of ingredients is going to determine, you know, what type of cake you get. So it's kind of along those lines.
Yeah.
Oh, it is almost 4 in the morning, and I'm starting to get really super sleepy, and you're probably able to tell.
Yeah. How about we wrap this up?
Yep. Sounds good. Too bad Rich was only able to stay for a short time, but he'll be with us again another time. So catch you guys later. I'm sure I can use my imagination as far as determining what you guys are about to go do. And as for everybody else watching, everybody have a good day, night, whatever it is on your part of the planet while you're watching this. And
bye-bye.
Bye.
Catch y'all later.